co-director of the Community for Global Health Equity, and it's great to see you here. Dr. Mandata is a funded recipient of the Seed Funding Award from the Community for Global Health Equity, and is going to talk to us today about low-cost global brain scanner with telemonitoring for neonatal asphyxia. But before you do that, can I just ask where you guys are coming from?
Okay, I guess I'll start. Brian, Dr. Dutta's master's student. I kind of have some familiarity with the device, so I just want to kind of understand a little bit more about it.
Hi,
Melissa.
I'm
Hi everyone, I'm Arsalan, I'm a senior biomedical sciences.
So Dr. Cortez is a faculty member, as am I, in the School of Public Health and Health Professions. Dr. Corey Smith is the other co-director, and he is of the School of Architecture and Science Bibelot, Architecture and Industrial and Systems Engineering. So we have a strong engineering crowd in the team. All right, so great, we look forward to hearing.
Thanks, Dr. Ram. Thanks to CGHE for funding this work. So this work involves two parts. So one part is done in the US, which is the MoRT device development site. And then there's a clinical study that's co-funded by the GC Grand Challenge Explorations in India. It's a co-funding that they are provided to test this device in India. In rural areas. So today, what I'm going to present is, this is my first presentation on this project. So I will kind of introduce why we need this kind of a brain scanner and why India. So that's kind of like how I will start my talk. And then after that, I will give some preliminary results that we have got in the last 6 months of this project. So that's where Radhika will present device that we are working on lab, and she is the project intern on this project. And also, I would like to also thank Dr. Satin, who was here when we submitted this proposal to CGHE. Now he has moved to UC Davis, but he remains in touch with me, and then we discussed. Of course, his team is here, so I have been working with, in fact, Brian, a student is working with. This team here, who are running the animal studies, and we hope to find the biomarker, because this device, part of it is basically the signal acquisition, but the other part of it is to find the biomarker that we can be able to. It's computationally not as expensive, so that we can run it in a mobile device and we can kind of do a point of care diagnosis. So that's kind of the idea. So now the problem statement. So to kind of introduce this this need, I would like to discuss this paper. It's a state of newborn health in India that was published in 2016. And what this says is that some of the things that I want to highlight from this paper are that is that India is one of the highest. India has one of the highest neonatal deaths out of any country in the world. And one of the important things about India is that there's a huge disparity. So there's this difference within states, between states, and also in India, different states have different socioeconomic statuses. So states are rich, some are poor. Within state, there is also a disparity. So that kind of shows in the data that I will show next on this paper. Now, this interaction is complex, so I won't go into this into discussing the complexity of why we have this disparity, but it because of like different demographics, different educational and socioeconomic status, and there's also biological and peer seeking factors that are responsible. So those are all kind of play together, that kind of leads to this disparity in the neonatal mortality rate. So I would like to introduce this neonatal mortality rate, which is basically for live births so after the birth within first 28 days, the number of deaths out of 2,000 live mentor. So that's kind of what gives us this NMR value. So with this device, we actually want to address this inequity. So we want to reduce this inequity by having some kind of a device that kind of cuts these barriers, right? So we want to have some technology that is cross-cutting and that can kind of intervene at a level where we can address this huge disparity. Now, to start with, so this is the map of India, and so our study is in West Bengal. So that's basically where this our collaborators are located. So in West Bengal is kind of like you see here, it's kind of a border. So the best state in terms of NMRs with the lowest NMR is Kerala. So that's the state here. So I will keep this in mind because by the end of the talk, I will actually say why I highlighted Kerala. But we would right now look into West Bengal. So West Bengal is where we have kind of a moderate NMR of about like 16 to 20. And the interesting thing is this rural, urban, and poor rich difference. So this rural, urban, poor rich difference is very high in Kerala, if you see. So in Kerala, it's difference of 60% or more. So in West Bengal, it's about 40%. So in West Bengal, overall NMR is high, but this divide is lower. So difference between poor and rich is lower. However, Kerala, which is our best state, has a difference of 60% or more. So the disparity is more starker in Kerala. So, and that kind of, by the end of the talk, I will kind of highlight why we selected West Bengal to start with, and then now we are going to Kerala to kind of look at how that will play in terms of the data that we look at. So now, in this neonatal mortality, the timing and cause is very important. So about 3/4 of the total neonatal death occurs within the first week of life. So the first week of life is where we have to have a point of care device that can somehow monitor the status, the neonatal health status. Now, out of that, the first 24 hours accounts for about 1/3 of the deaths out of the whole entire neonatal period. So, first 24 hours becomes more important. And then we all know that in India, the preterm birth complications, the major reason is neonatal deaths. Is complications and infections. So the hygiene is kind of like the primary aspect that needs to be addressed. So that's kind of like the number one major cause. But then after that comes this perinatal asphyxia. Perinatal asphyxia is basically defined as a failure to establish breathing network. So that's that happens actually in fact quite commonly. So I came to know about this much more from Dr. Satyan when after he came here. So this is actually a very common thing that happens, and it kind of addressed by certain medical techniques which are called resuscitation. So resuscitation techniques, training resuscitation techniques is actually one of the primary goal for the community health workers. So the patient is very important. And if the baby is resuscitated well, then the baby is in fact survived, and it's an intact survival. So now here what I want to highlight is this perinatal asphyxia is the other significant cause of neonatal mortality. In fact, it comes right after the complication of infection at the birth. And almost all deaths, 97.8%, that occurs in the first week of life. The deaths due to perinatal asphyxia that occurs within the first week. And out of it, 70% occurs within the first 24 hours. So why I'm kind of highlighting this is this first 24 hours in terms of timing is very important. And that's the part where there's a need for a point of care device, a testing device. Now, there's another thing that's kind of overlooked is the stillbirth rate. So stillbirth rate in India is quite high. It's almost 22% for 1,000, 92 for 1,000 births. So 22 babies out of 1,000 have the stillbirth. Now there is this thing is how we classify stillbirth. So ideally, stillbirth is basically when the baby is born dead, right? So when the body, when the baby exits, it's basically fetal death, so it's basically born dead. However, in many times, live-born infants who are inadequately resuscitated also misclassified as stillbirth. And this happens formally in India, also many developing and other countries. So this classification issue is there. And a lot of this this inadequate representation is due to lack of training, but also the lack of identification of this hypoxic injury to the baby. So usually it's basically turning off the color of the skin. So I was actually in India and I was looking at how this community health workers are trained. So they basically are, they look at nail and all and identify hypoxic injury based on the color. But that's actually too late. It's a very severe hypoxic injury. But anytime, like, you know, the hypoxic injury is moderate, and that they won't be able to identify. They will resuscitate. I mean, resuscitation is, there is still proper resuscitation, but it, the time that they spend before resuscitate is also important. That I will go over later in this talk. So why time is very important? Why have to, if there is a hypoxic injury, we have to resuscitate almost immediately. Now, here, I want to highlight this role of mobile phones. Now, of course, in India, this is something that's known and government has been intervening, and there's a lot of initiatives. For example, Janani Suraksha Yojana and Janani Shishu Suraksha, those are all there. However, this this interplay that I mentioned is so complex that these interventions, they are not showing results. I mean, they are showing results, but they are not showing the results at the level at which we want them to work. So they are. So we actually need something that's cross-cutting, that's basically is not affected by this interplay, right? Which is basically goes across. And that's where mobile and internet comes. Now in India, one interesting thing is this like happened primarily in the last 3 to 4 years with the arrival of inexpensive Chinese mobile phones. So now mobile phones are so cheaply available, and also because Indian companies have invested in this mobile infrastructure so much that we have pretty much the penetration. If you look at in metro, boom towns, developed rural, niche cities, rest of urban, emerging rural, under, every place has about 80% penetration of mobile phones. So mobile phones kind of, you can say, is cross-cutting. It's basically cutting all barriers. It doesn't matter whether a person is rich or poor or rural area or urban area. Everyone has got a basic mobile phone. Now, internet penetration is not that good. However, this is changing. This is data from 2016. Reliance is one of the big companies in India. They introduced Jio, which is kind of now this data is now mobile data is not pretty much available everywhere. Anyway, so that has kind of happened last year. But in general, the penetration of mobile phone is very good. And this has happened in the last 5 to 6 years. And that's why what we think is that if the point of care sensor has some intelligence, and then if the point of care sensor can somehow relay the distress, or for example, distress call, doesn't have to be really a IoT device, right? So it can just be a distress call to a remote center to call for help. That's all we need. So this is basically what we are kind of focusing on with our point of care sensor. So the point of care sensor, what we're saying is, if the point of care sensor can, with high sensitivity, may not be specificity, but with high sensitivity, can detect this hypoxic injury, severity of hypoxic injury, and if it can relay that information, not just information, just a flag, to a remote center, a remote call center, that can provide help. So the, if mobile device, it will relay the location as well as the as well as this severity scale, then that's what we need to deliver help, which is, so I will go over that. So that's kind of a platform that our collaborator has developed in India, and we will use that platform, telemodule platform for that. Now, before I go there, I would kind of want to go over a little bit over this, whether this is evidence-based or not, right? So I'm like saying we have this mobile device, we have the sensor. So sensor with mobile device interface is all good. So there are a lot of already in market, there are a lot of devices which are interested. Mobile phone can relay the data, can do remote monitoring and everything. But when we focus on the sensor, so what's the evidence that a sensor like what we are proposing will work? So before kind of I introduce what's there in the sensor, I would like to just go briefly over this hypoxic ischemic and So what this happens is that, so after perineal asphyxia, that's basically the insert, there is a decrease in oxygen delivery to the brain tissue. And because oxygen is necessary for energy production, so there is a decrease in the energy delivery to the liver tissue. That's the insert. And then the dissociation happens and there is a reperfusion. So there is this, how much is this hypoxic duration? How long was this hypoxia? Is basically differs from person to person, right? So that's basically one variable that kind of changes from person to person. Then we have recidivation. If recidivation doesn't happen, then of course the baby dies. There is so that's basically a failure and there is not much to do. But if there's a reperfusion, then the blood supply is restored. And the oxygen supply is restored. But then after that, what we are looking at is basically how the neural status changes because of the recovery, right? So some babies recover, some don't. And that's basically the question that we are trying to ask, is basically what we can identify or what marker we can identify during this phase, and maybe during within 6 hours, during this phase here, that kind of can lead us to kind of the prognosis, the recovery. So now, in this state, there are two things. So one is basically this latent, what happens to tissue right at that instant, I mean, when the reperfusion happens. There is cell death, so the cells can die. Then there is basically, because neuronal firing decreases, and then you have oxygen supply, so there's hyperoxia. So we have more oxygen than what is required, and that gives us the oxidative stress. So the oxidative stress affects neurons, so that's one aspect of it. Inflammation is also triggered because of this insert, so that's also there. Then this excess proximity, sometimes there is a seizure in the tissue. So all these things are something that we want to capture with our sensor, right? So we know that we want to capture this. Then beyond that is basically the secondary injury. Now, so after the insert, you have this primary energy failure, then you have reperfusion, and then infraversion. The latent phase, there is evidence that EEG can provide us a marker at that stage. And then after that, when one goes into the secondary, that's from 6 to 12 hours up to 3 days, then there are a lot of things that can happen which we are actually not addressing with our device. So we are actually addressing first 6 to 12 hours. But this also can be addressed if we have a continuous monitoring in the same device. So that's kind of like where we are going. So we are primarily targeting this part of this phase, the latent phase. And then we are saying, okay, if the baby is then moved to a neonatal NICU, then the baby can be the monitoring can be continued in the NICU from 6 to 12 hours to 3 days or 6 to 4 hours. That's kind of our goal.
So, I mean, just to put this together with the previous couple of slides around mobile, so if I understand you correctly, basically what you're saying is that if you go forward to that one more. Yeah. So essentially, a baby may be asphyxiated at birth, so not breathing at birth. The duration of asphyxiation is going to vary from baby to baby. Assuming the baby starts breathing after birth, then there's a reperfusion happening. So there's an increased oxygen delivery to certain parts of the brain. Or just in the process of that, now oxygen is being delivered, you can have some adverse consequences of that, which include kind of some of this oxidative stress, the inflammatory reactions, and the perturbations that might lead to epileptic type of seizure and so on, right? And so it's those kind of signals that are happening in the brain that you might be able to capture with your point of care sensor. And the mobile device is really about, can we relay that information to then a care facility that could bounce back recommendations for managing the baby on the way to care. Is that accurate?
Yes, exactly. So we are actually not going beyond 6 hours. So the battery life and everything is designed for 6 hours, designed for 10 hours, but about 6 to 10 hours is the period. So right after birth, up to 6 to 10 hours is when you can have the device on the baby and you can monitor it. And it will keep monitoring it as soon as it gets the biomarker, if it shows goes above the threshold, saying there's a severe injury, then it makes a call to the remote. But we would After this duration, this period is not what we are addressing with this device right now, which we hope will be done in NISBA.
And
Ivan,
can I ask a
yes.
question as well? So, you know, this requires resuscitation for the device to go on. So you're essentially not diagnosing something that might have happened in the birth canal or shortly after birth. You're basically assuming that the baby will be resuscitated, and then you would be putting the device on the baby to monitor the condition. Is that right?
So basically a baby survives asphyxia,
yeah,
and now we're concerned that there's going to be brain injury.
Right.
We need to do some quick diagnosis.
Yeah. So this actually kind of got worked. Earlier when we submitted a proposal at that time, we actually wanted to say that right after birth we'll put the device. But in fact, it's only useful if the baby is resuscitated, mm-hmm. and then after that there is this therapy called hypothermia therapy. So if the severity of injury is high, so moderate to severe injury, injury, then the baby should be given this hypothermia therapy, and for that the baby has to be moved to an ICU. So that's kind of where we are going with this. So if we identify any abnormality here, which is severe, then we will address this. But yeah, you're right. So after resuscitation, we'll put the.
And what you were talking about in terms of the trainings that are being done, so those are, you know, there are a number of like neonatal resuscitation programs. So the most widely applied one is Helping Babies Breathe, which is a comprehensive training program developed by the American Academy of Pediatrics and implemented by various partners. But that's all about improving neonatal resuscitation in the hands of low to moderately skilled health workers, right, who might be there at the time of birth.
Yeah.
But so then what happens as soon as the baby's resuscitated in terms of the care provision?
That's a big gap. That's the most important step. So I think so in India also we have this a lot of focus on community health workers. They are actually not really physicians. They are like trained to, for example, in maternal health and delivery of babies. And they actually are all being trained for this patient. So that's kind of something that we expect here and then. How good is the situation, or what's the state of the baby after the situation? Okay, so now one of the signals that has been used for quite a long time is this amplitude integrated EEG. By quite a long time, I mean this was kind of 20 years back. It was proposed, but in 1990s, it was kind of validated in animal studies. Where this signal. Okay, so now first I would like to go over what EEG is. So when there is a neural activity, you can think of it as like a flow of current. So that current flow causes a voltage distribution, and that voltage distribution, or potential distribution, you can detect at the scalp level. So it's completely non-visible. So you can detect at the scalp level the change in the current. And as the neurons fire, this thing changes, and you see that change in the voltage. And it looks like something like this. So it's zero mean modulated noise, you can think of it like that. So now for amplitude EEG, what we do is we basically first rectify it. So where we say, okay, let's move all the negative part of the signal to positive, and then we fit an envelope on this. So once we fit an envelope, then after that you break it in small bins or windows, and then find what's the maxima and what's the minima. And you just pick those maximum and minima, and then you show that to the clinician. Clinicians are now are trained to read this kind of signal to find out, based on this upper margin and lower margin, the severity of the injury. But this, again, I wanted to again highlight that this is not a prognostic feature or marker. It's basically right at that point or right at that time, based on the activity of the neuron, we identify how the neurons are doing. So whether it's a dysfunction or not, and that's basically. Now this can be shown in different ways. So you can have like a time compressed or an amplitude compressed. An amplitude compressed, you do a logarithmic scale on the amplitude and you show it. So there are different ways of showing the data, but basically the idea is to show this envelope after rectification. Yes. Now, so there's this paper in 2009 which kind of shows one important thing that I wanted to highlight here. So now, if you look at this table here on the left, is we have different. So this is on piglets, animal piglets, and adult piglets. They are different subjects. Now the hypoxic time is comparable. So we have like 40, 45 So 40, 45, 30 minutes, 40, 45 minutes here. Now the oxygen level that was supplied is comparable, but the histology, that's from the histology we actually found the ratio of ischemic neurons to the total number of neurons. That's basically how much damage. So higher the number is, more damage it is, more damage to neural tissue. That's basically cortical layer 4, I had 5 neurons. So this is after 4 days after dissipation. So this is 4 days after dissipation, you take the EEG, you get the upper margin of the EEG, that's AEG. So you take the upper margin of the AEG, lower margin of the AEG, and you look at this data and compare that with the histology data to see if there is any correlation or not. So now if you see here, so this hypoxic time was 30, and the animal was normal. This hypoxic time was 30, but it was a severe injury, 1. So almost all neurons had an ischemic death. So basically what this shows is that, of course, EEG right at the time of diagnosis or screening can show us the severity of the injury. So how severe is the effect on the neurons? And that you can see here. So normal, the range is 37, the upper range is 37.2, lower margin is 9.5. However, for severe, it's 5.2 and 1.3. So you get the upper and lower margins come together, right? They are kind of compressed when compared to a normal result. So normal results, you can think of it as, will have a very high variation, while this variation kind of gets lower and lower in a severe case. So this is kind of used, now it's been used quite commonly, and there are a lot of devices, easy devices in clinical use, which provides us a feedback of this AEG parameter. But the thing that we want to take home from here is basically the hypoxic injury is relatively comparable. There's no hyperoxia or hypoxia, so the oxygen content is in the oxygen supply to the platelets are similar, but still there is a difference in the injury 4 days after dissipation. EEG shows a good correlative, AEG predicts, not predicts, actually, captures the injury quite well at that time, so at 4 days after dissipation. However, if you look at what happens if it's a prognostic marker or not, if it's predictive or not. So now, of course, this comes from the other study that a persistently abnormal EEG for 48 hours is associated with an adverse neurodevelopmental outcome. So if you have a persistent abnormal EEG, it's bad. But the positive prognostic value of 6-hour EEG is 4. So if you take an EEG for 6 hours and you want to use that kind of to see how good is the outcome, that's not that good. Prognostic value is not that good. And in fact, good outcome may happen even with abnormal EEG.
Okay, so at 6 hours, it's not very good in terms of predicting.
In predicting the outcome.
A lot of variability, whatever.
A lot of variability.
And then at 48 hours, it's getting better.
So at 48 hours, basically first what happens is you have the hypoxia, where you have a decrease in oxygen. That then causes neurons to, neuronal dysfunction. There is a time delay in there. So first 6 hours in hypoxia, the neurons may function okay. And you won't be able to detect that in EEG unless you actually monitor that for 48 hours. So the EEG on its own, although can give a good idea at that point what neurons are doing, but neuronal function by itself may not show how bad is the injury. At the early stage, at first 6 hours. So the first 6 hours is, since we are focusing on first 6 hours, so whoever said, okay, AEG is good, but may not be good for the purpose that we're going to address. So then we said, okay, so now what comes first? First comes hypoxia. So if there is a way to look into hypoxia, so yes, there is. So we can use optical techniques for that. Now for optical techniques, there is this window, 600,000 nanometer window where the skull will be transferred and we can look into the distribution of oxygen, deoxygen hemoglobin. So the idea is basically to find in the neural tissue how much is the oxygen, deoxygen hemoglobin by shining light, transferring it, so it's completely not visible.
Now the idea is here minimum you need 2 airplanes and within this 600,000 elevator, which is available, those kind of LEDs are available in quite cheaply, so low cost LEDs are available. And the algorithm is basically that if there is a decrease in cerebral oxygenation, and so first we look at whether what happens at the brain tissue. So that's the first signal. The second signal is what happens at the scalp tissue, so that's basically the skin. Now if you have both a decrease in cerebral oxygenation and a decrease in peripheral oxygenation, then that's basically in hypoxia. And then if, so this is important because this is something that clinicians look for. They look for whether it's an hypoxia or an ischemic hypoxia. Another is if there is a decrease in cerebral oxygenation, however there is not a decrease in peripheral oxygenation, which is the skin, then it's an ischemic hypoxia. So we can, with this NIRS, can differentiate between hypoxic hypoxia and ischemic hypoxia. That's kind of one feature that we are extracting from the NIRS signal. Now, now go over this, so how good is this NIRS technology, right? So this is something that has already been used as FDA approved for babies. It has emerged as a safe and non-visible technology. It's been used in adults and babies. So we are sure that we'll get approval if we keep the intensity of the light or the power of the light within the safety criteria. So that's kind of, so this is good for in human application. Now, based on the data, we also know that we can look into hyperoxia. So more oxygen than what's normal, less oxygen than what's normal, more carbon dioxide in tissue than what's normal, less carbon dioxide in tissue than what's normal. This all four we should be able to identify with our signal, which is the oxygen protein and the oxygen protein. So based on how that changes after the sedation, so how the sedation changes this, we should be able to find what's the condition of tissue. So, and this is basically if oxygen saturation of tissue is going up or down, or carbon dioxide partial pressure is going up or down. So this is kind of the kind of features that we want to extract from NIRS. So the EEG on its own is AEG, NIRS on its own are these features here. Now, the third thing that we are now looking into is this coupling, so neurovascular coupling. So this is a very recent paper, and this being shown that it's a very good prognostic biomarker. This is also something that we want to, so this all we want to run in the handheld device, right? So we have to be computationally, it shouldn't be computationally that much expensive that we cannot run it on a regular, like a low cost handheld device. So now that's basically one of the reasons why we want to actually go in this particular algorithm last, because this is computationally expensive. So we'll first do the first two, AEG and then the NIRS features, and if they don't predict well, then we'll go into this wavelet technology. However, this wavelet coherence has been shown to be a very good marker, a very good prognostic marker. So in this paper, what they've shown is that the NVC coherence was significantly decreased in HIE newborns when compared to non-HIE controls. So when you have HIE, this NVC coherence goes down. That's been shown very robustly. Now the second is that so those with abnormal outcomes 24 months after HIE, so those who have abnormal outcomes, they had more significantly lowered NVC coherence than the normal outcomes. So even with babies who had who has HIE, so this is the HIE with non-HIE. Now within HIE also, if you have lower NVC coherence, then they have worse outcomes than those who have normal outcomes after 24 months. So this looks like a very good marker that we should, but there is some issue, some challenges, computational challenges on running this in our device. So that's kind of why we are going to go into that. Okay, so this is the sensor that, this is the device that we are proposing. So right now we are working on a one unit. So basically the idea is to kind of add it in on the scalp strategically to capture different vascular territories. So that's kind of the idea. So we have, so Radhika will present the single unit, which is basically a modular design. So that unit will connect to some transceiver, which will have this basically is connected to all those individual sensor modules, but also will have an accelerometer, will have a local data storage, and will have a wireless data output. So this is connected by Bluetooth to a handle device. And in the handle device will run the algorithm. And the handle device will then, it's a mobile device that can then communicate with the remote control center. So clinical studies are by Automatic in India. So they are incubated at the Industrial Management Calcutta, India. And this study is funded by GC, Grand Challenge Exploration. So they already, before they participated in this particular project, they already developed this training platform called KMS. www.kms.in is the website. The idea is basically that they will have a database of based on location, the private hospitals, the ambulances, government hospitals, and blood banks. So one can just go here and then can type in the location that they want to search for, and it will provide them information on what's the nearby private hospitals and what's the availability, bed availability. So what is CCU, the index of care and bed availability. Also, what the nearest ambulances that serve that area. Then what are the government hospitals nearby and the banks nearby. So this is kind of the idea. Now, they developed this, which has been in operation for the last 4 to 5 years now. 4 to 5 years now. What we want to do is, right now, as a first kind of like a concept, to prove this concept, the handle device, once it finds this severe injury, so basically the distress, they will make a distress call. This is basically an audio call. So the idea is basically that the report would be converted into an audio message, and that would be sent to the emergency center. So we won't be using the data. Mobile data won't be used. So we'll use, so initially, first when we started, we wanted to use the mobile data. However, we realized that it's not that robust in a lot of remote areas. So we'll use this like an audio call. The emergency center can then contact the mobile device, call the mobile device, and can coordinate the channel. So that's kind of going with this. So now, I think I'll just kind of briefly. So this this device we call Bragmos. This multi-weapon multi-resistance. This is not new. This already is there. But all the devices that are currently used are basically laser. Use laser darts and photometric lab tubes. So they actually are very expensive. So the idea is basically to use multiple wavelengths to look into multiple chromophores in the tissue. And with multi-distance, we would be able to have a depth resolution. So we would be able to separate the skin from the brain. Now I guess Radhika will present the sensor.
Can you
talk about that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So the IC in the first picture, that is the spectral sensor that we are using. Why we selected this sensor is because of the two important features that it has. It can detect six different wavelengths of light in the infrared region, that is from 610 to 600 meters. And this is because of the silicon interference filters that the sensor has. So these filters, whatever intensity is, whatever light is incident on the filters, they transmit some spectral bands and reflect the others, having a absorption coefficient of nearly zero. So the intensity that falls on the sensor is like almost two to what intensity it was, and plus you get six different wavelengths of light. And it on the sensor board, it has a programmable LED driver. So the use of the LED driver is, suppose you want to connect the light source to the sensor, then you can control the intensity of the light source by supplying the current that can be programmed from 10 milliamperes to like almost 100 milliamperes range. So that is again one of the useful features to control the intensity of the light source. And it supports I2CA and SPI protocol for communication with programming devices. And to test the sensor, I used an Arduino Uno. It is an 8-bit microcontroller and has a 16 megahertz clock frequency. So this is sufficient for the exchange of data between the sensor and the microcontroller. Also, it supports I2C and SPI, which is needed for the communication with the sensor. and plus it's low cost and open source, so it's very easy to code and flexible to use. And in future, I will be integrating this with the Bluetooth Shield for wireless data transmission. As Dr. Dutta explained, that we'll be using the multi-wavelength light source. The problem was the multi-wavelength light source are not readily available in the market. So my colleague Poonima, who's also a student of Dr. Titus, she fabricated a light source which has an array of LEDs of 8 different wavelengths. So like if you see the black region here, the tiny region, they are the 8 LEDs. So which you can imagine size is 350 to 350 micrometer. And they work at the power, they work at around 20 milliampere current, which can be supplied by the programmable LED driver on the board. So the sensor, I tested the sensor using a spectrometer. And so like this is the visible region of the spectrum and this is the near infrared region. And you can see there is a difference in there's a shift in the wavelength for all the LEDs. Like this is the spectrum for LED 1, for 2, 3, 4 and so on. So for example, it has a peak at about 750 nanometer. This has a peak about 800, this has at about 830 and so on. So the LEDs they worked fine when we tested. And these are the other four LEDs. To collect the preliminary data, this is the software that I developed. It has following features. The data gets directly stored into a text file. And the data has a date and timestamp to it. And also, it eliminates any kind of complex settings. Like for example, for data collection, the collection can start with just a simple click, and it can end with you don't have to do any settings for data acquisition. So how it works is, I'm using two softwares for that, processing software and Arduino. The Arduino software controls the microcontroller and takes the data, and the processing software is what adds all these features to the code. So actually what happens is, in the laptop, the Arduino is connected through the USB to the laptop, and that is like the ROM board, and Arduino instructs the microcontroller to take data. And when the device is communicating the data back to the Arduino, that's when the processing software reads the data. So that's how both these softwares read the same data at the same time. This is the logic flow. First, the LED is illuminated, and then the sensor takes the readings into the different channels, and that's printed. And what processing does is it creates a text file, and then checks if the serial device is present at the specified COM port, and if the device is detected, then it collects all the readings that the device is transmitting, and it prints them on the text file. And then it simultaneously adds the time and date stamp, and when the user wants to finish the data acquisition, the user can just press a key on the laptop and it will save the file and stop the program. This is the enclosure for the sensor that I printed in Autodesk Inventor. This is the cavity where the sensor will be placed, and there is a slit for a connector for connecting it to the Arduino, and this is the lid with opening for the MIR spectral sensor and the LED. There were also experiments done on animal studies, experiments are going on, and the signal processing is done by Brian, and Dr. Jayashree, Dr. Praveen, Sylvia, Carmen, and Mr. Justin, they are our clinician collaborators from the department.
Thanks, Radhika. So this is something that is a kind of more research project that we are doing separately from this big project here. So this, like if we identify some, so there are a few features that I already mentioned that we would look at immediately. I award